Hey there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory, and I've been using all kinds of telescopes for over 30 years. In this extra episode of Star Hopping, we're going to finish up our exploration of how to buy telescopes for beginners, kids or adults that are just getting started in astronomy and learning the night sky. Last week, in part one, we discussed the three variables you need to consider in selecting a telescope, and in this episode, part two, we'll tell you where you can buy them and how much you can expect to pay. More about all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 8 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I think it's totally freaky to be your host. So this is the second part of our star hopping extra. Occasionally, we'll need to discuss some other interesting areas of amateur astronomy while we're waiting for the stars to rise a bit. This is one of those times, since in the recent episodes, we've covered everything in the eastern sky until about the end of November. We'll get back to our deep sky targeting techniques next week. So I just want to reiterate that this episode finishes our discussion of how to buy a telescope for a beginner. If you haven't seen part one, I would highly suggest that you go back and check it out before watching this one. Just click on the movie thumbnail below to check it out. So with all that said, let's proceed and talk about telescope mounts. The type of mount determines what you can do with the scope. If you're interested really only in visual observing and want an easy, intuitive way of pointing the scope and locating objects, then the Dobsonian scope design is best for you. This type of telescope was pioneered by John Dobson of the San Francisco Sidewalk Astronomers in the early 90s. This is an altitude azimuth mount, meaning that the motion of the mount is along and at a right angle to the horizon. This is a very intuitive way to locate and find objects. You move right, left, and up, down. Perfect for star hopping like we normally do on our show. But if you want to take some astrophotos with your scope, this is not the way to go. Enter the equatorial mount. This type of telescope mount moves in the same way that the stars move, rising in the east, setting in the west, and rotating around the pole star, Polaris. This type of mount needs some additional setup time because you have to align the main rotation shaft to point at Polaris. Once that's done, the mount can use special gear motors to track the stars. This means that the object you are looking at will remain centered in the eyepiece over a long period of time, which is really nice. You can take time and really examine a celestial target without having to bump the scope along to keep the object centered in the eyepiece. This also allows you to attach a camera to the telescope to take time exposure to the sky, like this one from KPO. An equatorial mount will allow you to grow into the hobby and expand what you can do with it. The downside is it's not as intuitive in locating objects, as sometimes you have to rotate both shafts to make the telescope move to the specific target. This gets complicated when you're looking at objects around the pole or low in the south. Additionally, now you need power to drive the motors and you'll be dealing with wires. But you definitely get used to it after using the mount for a little while. There are other combinations of these mounts, such as polar fork mounts and Altaz fork mounts, usually paired with the folded light path scopes from companies like Mead and Celestron. But the concepts are the same. They either move around the pole, like an equatorial mount, or they move along and at right angles to the horizon, like an Altaz mount. Very often these scopes are computerized and are definitely more technical. Speaking of technology, one of the main new advances in telescope that have appeared in the last 10 or 15 years or so are go-to mounts. These are computerized telescopes that automatically move and locate deep sky objects. The concept is fabulous because you don't have to know how to find all these objects, and these telescopes have integrated databases of thousands of objects. But in my opinion, this is not the way to go for a beginner telescope for two main reasons. One, the initial setup is complicated. The methods used for setup varies between manufacturers, and if you don't get it right, the scope won't be able to find anything, which is very frustrating for a new user. I've seen people buy these fancy scopes and end up never using them because they spend more time trying to figure out how to make the scope work than in actually looking at celestial targets. Two, using a go-to system will really prevent you from learning the sky because the scope finds everything for you. one ends up having no idea where the object is actually located. This is similar to the calculators in school issue years ago. I know I'm dating myself there. But it's my opinion that it's important to learn how to find these objects in the sky manually. It allows you to be familiar with the sky, and you can generally help people in their object location, which is one of the best parts of organized astronomy. Once you're proficient at finding celestial targets, then it might be okay to move up to a go-to system. Okay, so this was all a huge amount of information. So let's sum it all up before we start looking at actual telescopes and places to buy. Again, the three main variables are cost, size, and type. Let's tie them all together here. An entry-level scope will cost less than about $200. The advantages are simplicity of setup, use, and storage. The disadvantage is that it's good for viewing the moon and bright planets only, and it won't give the ability to see much detail. A mid-range scope will cost $200 to $500. The advantages are increased aperture to allow you to see fainter objects like star clusters, nebula, and galaxies, and to give you options like additional eyepieces to change magnification. The disadvantage is increased size and longer setup and breakdown time. At the top end of this range, you'll be able to get into equatorial mounts, which will allow you to do basic astrophotography at the cost of requiring power and dealing with wires. A high-end consumer range scope will cost $1,000 and above, but this will allow you to view the full range of deep sky objects on the Messier and NGC lists. It'll allow you to get into astrophotography and will include go-to mounts. The disadvantage is increased complexity, increased size, and even longer setup and breakdown time. So, what scopes can we buy and where do we get them? There's tons of telescope suppliers out there, and you can find them on the internet and in magazines like Sky and Telescope and Astronomy Magazine. But my favorite source and where I normally send people is Orion Telescope Center, which can be found on the web at www.telescope.com, not telescopes with an S, as there's another site named that way that I'm really not familiar with. Just to be upfront, I'm in no way affiliated with Orion Telescope Center. I just like them, and I've bought many scopes and accessories from them over the years. So I guess that's a good testimonial. So here are some example telescopes that they have in the three ranges and options. You can find the links to all these products down in the episode notes. First of all, let's look at their refractor telescopes at three cost levels. At the lowest price, I would suggest the StarBlast 70 Altazimuth Travel Refractor Telescope Kit at $129. This is a basic Altaz-mounted scope with a 70mm objective lens, which is about 2¾ inches in diameter. This kit includes three eyepieces, astronomy software, and a few entry-level books. Seems like this one would be a great scope for children getting started out in astronomy. At a mid-level price, I would recommend the AstroView 90mm EQ Refractor Telescope Kit at $399. This is a much larger scope on an equatorial mount with a 90mm objective lens, which is a little over 3.5 inches in diameter. This kit includes two higher quality eyepieces, several filters for enhancing views of the moon and planets, astronomy software, and a few reference books. I don't have a recommendation for a high-end refractor, as the next level jumps to almost $1,600 and it's a go-to mount, which I don't recommend for beginners. Moving on to reflectors. At the low end, I would recommend the StarBlast 4.5 Astro Reflector Telescope at $210. I have this scope, and I would highly recommend it for your child. It has a 4.5-inch mirror, and that means it can see nearly all the planets and many deep sky objects. It doesn't have a lot of magnification, but it presents bright, sharp images. It's also very small, as it's a tabletop telescope. At the mid-range, I would highly suggest the SkyQuest XT6 Classic Dobsonian Telescope and Beginner Barlow Kit at $360. I also personally have one of these scopes, and it is really excellent and for a great price. This is a 6-inch telescope, and at that aperture, you can see nearly the entire Messier list of deep sky objects. This scope will easily show you the rings of Saturn and the moons of Jupiter and really kicks butt on the moon. And at the high end, a great choice is the SkyQuest XT12i in telescope, Dobsonian telescope, at $1,250. This scope includes a system that guides you to deep sky objects as you push the scope. I'm okay with this kind of system because it still does make you notice the star patterns as you move the scope toward your target. Usually these systems are much simpler in setting them up so that they're oriented to the stars. Be aware though that this is a large 12-inch scope that will not fit in compact cars. And regarding compound scopes, the price tag is generally higher, but they're definitely more compact. Meade is the brand to buy here for starting out. Orion has a couple, but this seems to be the best choice in my opinion. The Meade LX70 M6 6-inch German Equatorial Mac Cass Telescope. Mac is Maksutov. And it costs $1,000. Other compound scopes in their offering are much higher priced, and they're really not in the ballpark for this tutorial subject of beginner telescopes. So, lots of choices here, but if you want me to narrow down the best choice, I would have to go with the SkyQuest XT6 Classic Dobsonian Telescope and Beginner Barlow Kit at $360. This is the best all-around telescope that can fit in small vehicles, but still will please the eye with the moon, the planets, and many deep sky objects. It's a great all-around scope to start someone out in astronomy. I hope you enjoyed this beginner's telescope buying guide. We'll continue to bring you these astronomy tutorials every week on Thursdays. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them to YouTube. If you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel down there, click the thumbs up, and please share it out to your friends who like looking at stars. If you happen to have any questions or comments on tonight's show, feel free to leave them below and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Also, please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astro photos and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value, and if you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a couple dollars per video, you can support our efforts and let us make even more great astronomy tutorials just like this one. Well, thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.